Hi guys, and welcome to this Databricks tutorial. In this episode, I'm going to show you how we can configure Git repository using GitLab, which is one of the popular Git provider out there. In addition, I'm going to show you how we can version control Databricks notebook. So let's get started. I'm going to swipe to gitlab.com. So in order to follow along in this project, you need to create your GitLab account with your email address and your password. And this can be done in about 3 minutes or less. And it's so straightforward and similar to how we create GitHub or Azure DevOps accounts. So in my case, I've done that already, and I'm going to create a project, and this is where I can collaborate. I can also store my codes and do all sorts of things. So I can see my details, and I'm going to click on this project, and I can see this welcome page. So I'm going to create a project. So click on that. I need to determine the kind of project I want to create, either from a blank project or from a template or from an imported project, or run a CI/CD for external repository. In our case, we want to create a blank project. And of course, I'm going to give this a name. Let me call this one Databricks CI/CD. And I need to choose the project URL. So this is going to be resident in my users. Now, we have two things. Now, when I choose groups, this project is going to automatically be a private project, and it's going to be visible to all the members in my group. But if I want this to be seen publicly on internet, I'm going to come here and choose the users. So in this case, I can see that when I toggle on, people on the internet can come to this project and see all the code and so on. So once that's sorted, I'm going to initialize this project similar to initializing the repository with a readme.md file. So this is ticked automatically, but if you don't want, you can unthick this project configuration. So that's sorted for me. I'm going to come to the bottom and create a new project. And in about 3 seconds or thereabout, the project is now created. And this is our Databricks underscore CI/CD repository. Amazing. Now, similar to other Git providers, we can see we've got the main branch where we perform the collaboration. And of course, we can create a feature branch for development and all sorts of things. We can see the readme.md file, and then we can see the initial commit and the last update, and then we can see all the details. Now, this can be a little bit so unfamiliar if you're new to GitLab, but it's actually straightforward and easy to understand. Now, we want to come back to Databricks, and then I want to go to the workspace because we want to create a Git folder in order to be able to clone the GitLab repo remotely into the Databricks workspace. So to do that, I'm going to click on this create, and then I'm going to create the Git folder. So I need to get the Git repository URL, and it's going to automatically detect the Git provider and of course the name of the repository. So I'm going to come back here, and in your project that is in your repository, I can see this code, and we can clone with HTTPS. So I'm going to copy that. I'm going to come back here and Ctrl V to paste, and this automatically detected GitLab as the Git provider. And of course, we can see the Git folder name. I can choose to rename, but I'm going to maintain and click on create Git folder. Now, this is going to be created but not fully authenticated, because we need to actually go to the settings and then go to the linked account and add the credential in order to fully authenticate to, in this case, GitLab. So I'm going to click at the top right hand corner, and I want to go to the settings, and I want to go to the linked accounts, and I can see that we are not fully authenticated, because if we are, we should be able to see that details here. So I'm going to add the Git credential, and I'm going to choose the GitLab. Now, don't confuse GitHub with GitLab, they are not the same providers. So I can maintain this nickname, and I'm going to provide my Git email address or the username. In my case, I'm going to use my username. To see that, in case if you've forgotten, just come back to your GitLab project, click on this, and I can see that here. So that's for me. And of course, we need to generate the token in order to be able to authenticate fully. So to get the token from the GitLab, I'm going to come back here again. Make sure you click on this icon and go to the edit profile, and then we can see the access tokens. So click on that, and then we can create a new token. Let's call this on demo, and can give a description if you choose. I'm just going to maintain this expiration date, and I'm going to define the scope that's going to be associated to this token. So I basically need the right repository which grants read write access to repositories on private projects using Git over HTTPS, not using the API. So click on this, and this is going to be the scope that is needed for this operation, and then we can create the token. So this can now create it. Of course, you need to store this in a remote and secure environment because you're not going to be able to see the same thing again in the future. So that is copied, and I'm going to come back here, get rid of this, Control V to paste, click on save. And this is now linked, so I can see this is sorted. Now when I come back here, and I can go back to the Git folder, and of course we can see the same readme.md file, but we are now fully authenticated. And again, we can see we've got the main branch. So if we want to perform any development work, we can create a feature branch that's going to be based on the main branch. So before I do that, I want to create a folder because I would want to organize my code. So I'm going to call this on sales folder, and I want to click on create. Now, creating folder is actually not compulsory, but if you choose, that's fine. So I'm going to go right into this main, and I can see the Git folder dialog box. So I've talked about this in my previous video where I talked about the automated Databricks CI/CD. So I'm not going to do much of talking on this today. So we want to create a branch, and let's call this on feature /create notebook. And don't forget, you can't have space in between this, it's not going to work. So you can put them together or use the underscore to bring them together. So I'm going to click create, and that branch is going to be created in about 45 seconds or less. This is now created, I can see that here. So I'm going to close this for now, and I want to quickly refresh my URL just to make sure I can see that feature branch created, sorted. Now we want to create our notebook, and let's give this a name. Let's call this on sales data processing notebook, and press enter. So I'm just going to quickly use this code to commit and push to the feature branch. I'm going to click on this, and it's going to take me back to the Git folder dialog box. And we can see the A. This simply means we've added a code, and then we can see the content of the code in the CMD that is in the first cell of the notebook. That's cool. I can see the name, and I can see the name of the folder we created. So let's call this one notebook creation, and let me just add sales data in PySpark as the description. And once I'm happy, I'm going to click on the commit and push to the feature branch. Now we're not pushing to the main branch, we need to create the PR in order to match the code in the feature branch to the main branch. So we can see this successfully committed and pushed changes to the branch that is feature /create notebook, and we can create the PR. Now before we create the PR, I'm going to come here, and I'm going to go back here, and I'm going to open the same project, and this is going to be in the main branch. So let's quickly switch to the feature branch we just created, and I can see the sales folder we created, and inside that I can see the notebook. So I can click on that, I can see the content of the PySpark code in the single cell. Absolutely awesome. Now we can create the PR from here, but I'm going to do that from the Databricks workspace. So I'm back here. When I click on the PR, a new tab is opened automatically, so I can forget about this for now. And I can see the title, and of course the description, and we can assign an assignee, and we can also assign a reviewer and all that. So once that's sorted, I'm going to come to the bottom, and then we have this delete source branch when merge request is accepted. So this is actually good in order not to have unnecessary feature branch in our repository. So I'm going to click on create merge pull requests. I'm just going to check if there's any conflict with the base branch, similar to what we have in GitHub and Azure DevOps. So this is ready to go. No conflict. If there's any conflict, there's going to be a prompt on the side. So I'm going to click on merge pull request. And in about 30 seconds or less, we have the code from the feature branch promoted to the main branch, and the feature branch is deleted automatically, as we can see from here. So let's go to the main branch and check the folder. So we have the folder here, awesome, and then we can see the code in the notebook. Absolutely cool, brilliant. Now let's quickly come back here, and then I'm going to, since this is deleted, switch back to the main branch, and I'm going to wait for this to load. And once this is sorted, I'm going to close this window for now. And when I see, come back here, I can see the code in the main branch, and I'm going to come back here just to check again. So I can see that here. Let me just step out. All right, so go back to the Git folder and I can see the sales folder, and then you can see the sales notebook, and then the code is promoted. Absolutely easy. Now let's create another feature branch to perform data transformation. So I can click on this from here and I can create a new branch. Let's call this one feature/data transformation, and I'm going to click on create. So this is going to be created again in about 45 seconds or less, and then we can access the notebook. So this is done. I'm going to close this for now, and in the feature branch we just created, let's go to the bottom and create a new cell at the bottom and Control V. So basically we have this data transformation, and once this is pasted, I'm going to click on this to go back to the Git folder, and you can see the end. So this implies we've modified the content of the IPNYMB notebook, and we can see the changes here in the cell number 2. Let's call this on data transformation as the title. Let's call this on transformation anyway. And once that's sorted, I'm going to click on the commit and push, and it's going to be committed and pushed to the feature branch, and we can create the PR. So this is done successfully. I'm going to come back here. Let's go to this place, or I can just refresh. And once that's refreshed, I can click on that again. I can see that's created. And when I go to the bottom of that notebook, I can see the cell number 2. Excellent. So let's go ahead and create the pull request. So click on that. And again, a new tab is open automatically, and we see the details. I'm going to come to the bottom, click on the create merge requests, and it's going to check for any conflict. In this case, we are ready to merge, no conflict. Click on the merge, and this is merged. And of course, that branch is deleted automatically, and we can see the changes merged into the main branch. So I'm going to come here to check it out. So I'm in the main branch, as we can see. I can see the folder again. I can scroll to the bottom of the notebook, and there we go. So we can see the contents of the cell number 2. Absolutely awesome. So what about if we want to version control, that is, we want to roll back these changes? Now before I do that, I'm going to quickly come here, and I can quickly switch back to the main branch, and I'm going to close this for now. And when I go to the bottom, I can see the cell number 2 with the data transformation. Now, what about if we want to roll back this merged operation? So we want to version control the notebook. How do we do that? So we have to do that from outside the Databricks workspace. So I'm going to come back here, and I'm going to go to this option, this merge requests. So in the merge request, we can see we have two merged, and you can see all the merged. So I'm going to click on this merge, and this is where all the records of the merge operations are stored. So I can see the first one is to create the notebook, and then the data transformation. So let's roll back this data transformation. So to do that, I'm going to just click on this, and I can see the option to revert. So I'm going to click on that, and it's going to create a new revert branch for me on top of the main branch. So I can say start a new merge request with these changes. Click on revert, and it's going to of course check for any conflict with all the titles and descriptions. So once this is fine, good to go, we approve this rollback. I'm going to click on the merge request, and of course it's going to be deleted automatically. Also click on this create merge request, and we can see we are ready to go. So I'm going to click on the merge, and this is now completed. Absolutely awesome. So I'm going to come back to Databricks, and let's go back to the workspace, and I'm going to go back to the main. Now you may not see this immediately, so you can see this little icon. So this tells you of all the pull requests that you can actually bring into the Databricks workspace. So we have pulling, will clear output, cell output, visualization dashboard in updated notebook. Are you sure you want to proceed? Of course, we are happy. Click on the confirm. So we are bringing the changes into Databricks, and I can close this for now. So just to make sure that everything synchronizes properly, I'm just going to refresh my URL. And when I go to the sales data processing notebook, and in the main branch, when I go to the bottom cell, the cell number 2 is vanished. So we are able to successfully roll back the content of the data transformation. So this is a very quick guide on how we can configure Git repository using GitLab Git provider. So I trust you enjoyed this video. If you do, please like, share, comment, and follow me for more videos, because there's a lot to come on GitLab. Thank you for watching. Bye for now. Cheers.